worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. Forest. Sweet. This is a bliss in the chilly forest. The wind in the branches. The birds hiding. The plants growing. All in peace and ease.
Friends, sati does not mean mindfulness, since mind is not full of anything, really. Rather, it is stilled into a precise, unique, one-pointed focus. Therefore, sati is much better translated as awareness or presence, which is one of the five spiritual abilities and powers. Indriya Bala, one of the seven factors of enlightenment. Buyanga, and the seven methods of the Noble Eightfold Way, Magga. It is, in the widest sense, one of those mental factors inseparably associated with all karmically advantageous, lofty, and beautiful kinds of consciousness. It is continuously established by the method, the core method called the Four Foundations of Awareness, Satipatthana. In the Noble Eightfold Way, it is called Sammasati, right awareness. And the characterization of right awareness goes like this. Awareness of wrong view, or right view being present right now, is right awareness. Awareness of wrong motivation, or right motivation, is right awareness. Awareness of wrong speech or right speech right now is right awareness. Awareness of wrong action or right action done right now is right awareness. Awareness of wrong livelihood or right livelihood is right awareness. Awareness of wrong effort or right effort at this very moment is right awareness. Awareness of wrong awareness or right awareness is right awareness. Awareness of wrong concentration or right concentration just now is right awareness. In this way does the path factor, right awareness, work together with, inseparably joined with, associated with, working in parallel and sequence with, simultaneously, all the other seven path factors of the Noble Eightfold Way. Ariyamaka. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 110, recorded the 1st October, the first day in the 10th month in the year 2018. In Denmark, in the middle of Zealand, on a chilly, chilly, chilly autumn day with clouds hurling over the blue sky. There are three questions as usual, revolving around no self and solitude, but first the normal intro. Namo, Tassu, Bhagavato, Arahato, Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Before I start regularly, I just like to say, click subscribe there. There's a ticket to Nirvana. Click the bell there and click the like button if you like. And secondly, because that is advantageous for all, not only for you, but also for other beings. So it's a blessing, in other words, for you and for them, karmically speaking. And there's a meditation course. I conduct a meditation course in North Carolina, USA, from the 20th December to the 1st January 2019. And it will go through all 40 classic meditation objects. It's a very nice place you see here, Hardwood Refuge. It's an old wooden hotel. And you can go to my website, whatbuddhasaid.net, and get the full program. We'll go through all 40 classic meditation objects, a lot of Buddhist history, and do a lot of sitting and walking meditation. See, the six core meditation method put forth by the Buddha, notably the Brahma Viharas and breathing meditation, Anapanasati, which all Buddhas use to gain enlightenment, they will be taught in detail and also trained and developed extensively. So I can highly recommend this to go and apply for a seat there. Then there is question 342. How can there be no self experiencing the karma, good or bad? Is it not contradictory? No, it is not. Because there's no self acting out this good or bad karma in the first place. And we just remember that karma is intention. And good karma is defined as generosity, that's the absence of greed, goodwill, the absence of ill will, and knowledge of the Four Noble Truths being present when the intention to either think, speak, or act is formed. That's good karma. These processes to form this or that intentions we call sankhara, mental constructions or formations. They're changing all the time, so there can be no ego or self or I or me that is the same inside this streaming shift of intentions, whether good or bad. So there's no actor there. That's the first place. However, the process of thinking, the process of intending, the process of responding to external stimuli and then intending with the same stimuli, with the same object that you have perceived. Example, seeing a soft ice, wanting the soft ice, buying the soft ice and eating the soft ice. There's a lot of karma there, or sharing it with another one, or buying two soft ices. This is all impersonal processes. They are conditioned events, conditioned by external stimuli, internal habituation of have bought soft ice before, and so forth. So there's no unchanging entity in there on the actor side. But it's still an individual process. It is this individual process called A, B, or Joe, this selfless stream of processes that is buying the software. But it is this very same stream, or not the very same stream, but the continuation of this stream that further down the timeline experiences the result, whether good or bad. So it's individual processes, but they are not identical with themselves. This means that there's no self. If there's nothing inside a process, which we typically call the five aggregates, or the five clusters of clinging, or the five khandhas, namely form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. This is what we call a being. There's nothing the same inside form. It's not the same form, nor inside feeling, nor inside perception, mental construction, or consciousness. They're always changing, so they're never the same. Since there are no sameness there, nothing that is identical with a sense, then there cannot be any identity hidden inside there, or outside there, or owing this form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. There cannot be. It's impossible. Because it's never the same. It is never unchanging. It is always in a transient state of flux. And therefore there cannot be any identity in there, or connected with them, either singularly or collectively. This is a little bit difficult to understand, but it can be summarized in the Buddhist saying, Sabba Dhamma Anatta. All states, all phenomena are no self. And if it's material phenomena like this tree, then there are no substance. They are coreless. They are empty of self. They are empty of entity. They are blinking processes, dynamic things. So they are only dynamics in Buddhism, no statics. But it's the other way around in Western philosophy and Greek logic, basically. They are only statics and no dynamics. But that the world is dynamic is obvious, huh? You see the monk moving and hear his voice as it's changing and so on. The leaves are rustling. But it's a quasi-stationary thing. It looks like the same monk and looks like the same forest. So you still, though there's obvious change taking place, then one tends to identify with the form, the feeling, the perception, the mental construction and consciousness, even though it's not the same from one moment to the next moment. On the experiencer side, then you can say, well, yes, let's say the example is of a river. You have a river and you take a cross-section, for example, of the Ganges. The Ganges has a certain name. But the river is always, if you look, stand at a certain place and put your finger down the water, then it's always something new water. Same thing with this stream of mental and physical processes that are streaming along. It's never the same. However, you can, if you put an apple down and drift in this ever-renewed Ganges, and then further go down the stream, you can say down in time, then you'll find the very same apple. And you can say it's a simile for experiencing the result of whatever action you have. You will find it in the same stream of consciousness and material phenomena, mental properties. You will not find it in another river, in another stream of processes. So the stream of the processes are individual. But since they are a stream of impersonal processes, then there are no identity in there. Except for the name. But the name is not the thing. The name Ganges is not the river Ganges. Huh? The river Ganges is not the thing on the map. It's actually the water flowing. That when it flows out in the ocean, then it loses even its name. It loses designation. Ganges then is just ocean. Same thing with this consciousness and that consciousness. When it enters Nirvana, then it loses its individuality. It cannot be designated as something separate from its surroundings. So this I think it helps to keep contemplating this form, feeling, perception, mental construction and consciousness as processes, as constant drifting things that are never the same. When one realizes that they are never the same, then one gives up the idea of I, me, you, they, and therefore also give up any false perception of separability between me and them, and thereby give up all egoistic behavior. And thereby one's karmic future is improved further downstream to be or to remain in the simile of the river flowing. That is only one individual rivers, and there are many rivers in the world. There are many beings flowing streams of consciousness in the world that experience what this processes as an automaton or robot have formed, constructed, put together further upstream in time. So there's nothing contradictory or mystical about it. But it is a little subtle, I have to say. selflessness, sabbadhamma anatta, anatta, no self, there's no self in there. Also, if egolessness is real, how do the hierarchy of social status come about? The Buddha was once asked, who is high or low, and how do you become beautiful or ugly, how do you become rich or poor? Yeah, disrespect will make one's reputation go down, then you'll not be famous. Respect, especially towards parents and teachers, this will make one's social status go up and one will be respected and have a good reputation. Not giving or stealing will make one poor. Giving and sharing will make one rich, and so forth. Being very mild-mannered and soft-spoken and not backbiting and critique will make the facial expression, especially the mouth, really beautiful. While backbiting and slandering and so on, being aggressive, scolding, will make one's physical appearance in the future very ugly. So again, it is just a matter of cause and effect regarding the individual stream. When I say one, then I mean one stream. I don't mean one identity, but I can say it's one individuality. And there's a very subtle difference between this, because identity is something that is the same from one moment to the next moment. This tree, for example, and this monk is not, this tree is growing and this monk is becoming older. This is not the same from one moment to the next moment, obviously, huh? It can move and it can breathe and it exchanges energy and materials like gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide with the surroundings at all time points. So it's never the same. However, we can say in conventional language, samujisatya, then we say it's the same tree and the same monk. But that's only a matter of social linguistic convention. It's not an absolute truth. Paramatta satya. So there's two levels of truth, relative and absolute. Paramatta satya will say that this also is no self, no substance. It has no substance. And this individuality has no self. Even though it has the same name, tree, monk, samahita, then it's not the same from one moment to the next moment. Change is obvious taking place. But still, it's linked phenomena. One is linked for the next. This state determines the next state, determines the next state, determines the next state. Whether is this physical mental flow, or whether is this only physical, biological flow of states. So this one state conditions the next state, conditions the next state. But this state doesn't condition or influence, at least not directly, other flows of the same thing, of similar thing, like other individual beings. So this means that there are, whatever this stream do up here, then because of this conditioning of moments, then it will experience the state, the social hierarchy state, high or low, according to what it did up here. So there's individual processes and streams. They can be separated, not fully, but partially separated from other streams, from other beings, but can also interact like we are doing, like we are doing right now. Huh? So we are exchanging information here, and thereby exchanging ways of behavior, and thereby exchange ways of coming to a future, both a near future and a very far future. But this doesn't mean that there is a self, that there is an actor, that there is an experiencer, that there is someone who receives the fruit or the result. There's fruit and the result. It comes out in the process. Let's say, for example, if we take this with social hierarchy, if you have this, again, this image of a river driving or flowing, that's compared to the conscious beings, then you can pollute the river up here with mud, then it will be muddy down there, corresponding to the low social status. Or you can purify it up here, take all the dirt out, then it will be a clear, very nice, pure river up here, but then it will also be a pure river down here if it's not polluted in between. But still, if one takes any cross section of it, any given time point, and see what's the river, then it's still an ever changing flow of atomic new atoms of water. So you can never dip your toe in the water in the Ganges and then experience the same water in the morning and the evening, or even at two consecutive moments. And the same here, you can never experience the same form, feeling, perception, mental construction and consciousness for this individual stream of consciousness and matter for two consecutive moments. They are never the same. They cannot be pulled back into the present. This selflessness, to experience that is bliss. It is said, the Buddha said, this is the highest bliss. This, because then one cuts this abysmal conceit, self-deception, that I am. That is an informational construct, the ego, inside a database that thinks it exists itself and thereby deceives itself. So it's self-deception in the second degree. It's an imaginary self that deceives itself about itself and comes to think that it exists. And then it keeps telling it that it lies every time it brushes teeth and in front of the mirror and sends an email. It is me who do that and experience the result of that. But that's not the case. It's not a me. There's experiencing, the process of experiencing this and that as a result of this and that. But this is not a me. This is just the experience itself that the experiences. It is perception itself that perceives. It is consciousness itself that is aware of something. It is not a self or ego that is conscious or have consciousness or possess consciousness or is inside consciousness or outside consciousness. It is not. This self is a hypothetical construct and nothing more than that. Unfortunately, a very tricky, subtle, treacherous and I also say detrimental, disadvantageous construct, because it induces egoistic behavior. That is the worst case scenario for the very same hypothetical ego, because it bounces back as pain and suffering for this very same ego. Trick is that, however, I like to say also that egolessness is particular to Buddhism. There's no other philosophy where you can go and hear about no self. So there's only one chance to hear it, that is to hear it from a Buddha or from one of his disciples, like you are doing right now. There's no other chance. There's no poets or philosophers ever in time. It takes a Buddha to discover this very subtle, but also very fundamental structure of this consciousness interacting with matter in the external world, this internal-external dualism, that there is no self in there, that is empty of self, and that the matter outside there or inside here is empty of substance. Very difficult to find out that, but one should keep training because it is releasing. If anything is releasing, then it's that. It comes first with release or relinquishment of the idea that the ego or the I or the me is connected with the body, has something to do with the body. Either that it is a body, is identical with the body, or it has a body, it possesses a body, is owner of a body, or it is hiding inside like a small man, like inside a robot, hiding inside the body somewhere, this self, this ego, this soul, or is outside the body, all over the place. And the same thing, that this self or ego or me or identity or soul, or call it whatever you will, it is inside feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness, or that it possess, owns feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness, or is inside it, is hiding inside somewhere inside it, inside feeling, perception, mental construction and consciousness, or outside the very same things. But that's not the case. This is 20 ways of identification with something that is not self and which only lasts a moment. Huh? If there were any self, for example, let's say within feeling, a moment of feeling, of pleasure or pain, that is only momentary, then the self should come and go incessantly. And the same thing goes with perception, mental construction and consciousness, which is also momentary, only lasts a moment. How can there be a self inside a thing that only lasts a moment? How can there be a same, stable, identifiable, identical self, ego, me, within something that lasts only a moment? It's impossible. It's an untenable idea, basically, from a more close-up analysis of the case. So there's an individual processes where one moment conditions the next moment, conditions the next moment, conditions the next moment. But this also implies that there's nothing ever being the same in there, in this very changing and exchanging process of arising and ceasing of form, feeling, perception, mental construction and consciousness. There's no self in there, no same self in there, because it is only arising and ceasing. I hope this clears the matter, but keep it's transience, impermanence is easy to see. This can be seen all over the place. Suffering, frustration is also fairly easy to see when one has first seen impermanence. But no self is a little more difficult to see, but keep trying. Because it's really releasing and liberating. If anything is, then it's this giving up the idea of me or mine, and I-making, and mind-making. Giving up this conceptual ego gratification that also evaporates all pride and arrogance right on the very spot. This is fundamental to the Buddha Dhamma, and also particular to the Buddha Dhamma, not found in any other philosophy or religion ever. Question 343. Is worshipping Nāgās good, and what about offering them merit? I would say no. Nāgās are not, they are kind of like dragon-like beings that are very interesting. In a natural form, they are like very huge snakes. They can live both on land, usually in caves, or in water, underwater, and stay there for a long time. They can be very large, very old, very powerful, but they are still regarded as non-human, but not usually enemy to humans, and some are even Buddhist. And you see some depictions of them here. They're not allowed to ordain. One monkey, you can only see that they are have a snake form when they're having sex or when they sleep. And one Nāgā, he liked to be a monk at the Buddhist time, and then he was staying in a small kuti together, small meditation hut together with another monk. And then this monk waked up, and then he saw there was snake everywhere. He said, snake this, a diameter of this, like a giant anaconda, with snake out the window, coming in the door, and everywhere there was snake. And he yelled and ran back to the Buddha and explained about it. And then the Buddha said to the snake being, "Ah, come here, summon this snake being, this Nāgā," and told him, "You cannot become a monk. You have to go back and keep the observance days completely pure, new moon and full moon." And then this Nāgā left with tears, crying, because he really wants to be a monk. Another very famous Nāgā waited down on the Niranya River when the Buddha, he put his golden plate and looked for it to go upstream. And then said to himself, "If this plate goes upstream, then I will be enlightened today." He was a Bodhisattva. Then it went upstream and sank and said clink, clunk, clink, clunk on the three other Buddhas' golden plate. So it sank exactly the same side. And there, a snake being who has been sleeping down there in the mud, huge, huge creature, Mucalinda, he said, now three Buddhas have gone, now a fourth has arrived. Yesterday, the three other Buddhas go, now today, the fourth has arrived. So he actually thought that this, probably in the order of 500 million years between the Buddhas, they have appeared to him like a day and night. And then he also protects the Buddha, as you can see here, during a big rainstorm in the days just after the Buddha's enlightenment. Very famous, you can see him all over the place. Various depictions which you see here. Mucalinda, the snake king. But though one should be friendly towards all beings and thereby also snake beings that one cannot perceive, then I would say one should worship the Buddha, the Dhamma and the Sangha, because this the snake beings, the Nāgās, also do. And then one should offer merit. One can only offer merit to the ghosts, the petas in one's family, seven generations back or forward. So even though if one offers merit to these snake beings, then they won't be able to receive anything. There's a story about when the Mahāstupa, which you see here on Sri Lanka, should be put down, then they should need some relics. And then a young Samahita, which has superpowers, he volunteered to fetch some relics from the Nāgās, which has some genuine relics. And this he did. The Nāgā king then gave his nephew the relics, which then the nephew made himself, this they can do, change their form. He made himself into a thin membrane over a large lake and swamp. But the Samahita, he was very smart, he knew that. And then the Nāgā had swallowed the relics, so they were down in his stomach. So the Samahita, he just lying on his bed there in Anuradhapura on Sri Lanka, and all the drums were already playing, and the king was, and the procession was coming, and so on, and they needed the relics. It was only 5 minutes to that they will need to the relics to put inside the stupa. Then he just put the arm down into the stomach of the Nāgā and then pulled up the relics. And then the Nāgā, he said, now I lost the relics. Even though he was a thin membrane over several square kilometers. So he's camouflaged himself very geniusly. Huh? But still the Samahita could see where he was and interact with his physical state from where he was. Probably because his space and time is, space-time is a something else than we think it is. Nevertheless, later on, the Nāgās, they came to the monks and said, could we make a share? Could we get a share of the relics? And then they shared the relics, so everybody has some relics, both in the Mahāstupa, which you see here, in Anuradhapura, and the Nāgās, in their kingdom, they also had some relics. So Nāgās, some Nāgās are good Buddhists, and worship the relics and the Buddha and Dhamma Sangha. So they are co-disciples and spiritual friends, Kalyanamittas, as such, but not more than that. They should not be worshipped as a deity or anything high, or not be offered merit either. In general, I would say, one should worship the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha, the three jewels, as a Buddhist, and they also do. Question 344. How do we become attached to people who are kind, nice, and generous to us, and how to come out of that attachment? Yes, in general, one can say one become attached to things that are pleasant. So when having contact with something pleasant, in this case, social company, that are generous and kind and so on, then it evokes a pleasant feeling. And then one wants the object and stay close to the object and wants to be associated with the object, have more social interaction with the same people, whether it's spouses or friends or Kalyanamittas, spiritual friends or whatever it is. So this clinging is aroused by this pleasant social feeling. Opposites, of course, is unpleasant feeling, then one wants to push them away, but still is clinging to the idea of pushing them away. And thereby aggression, hate, dosa arise. And if contacts to some social interaction doesn't give any either pleasant feeling or painful feeling, then it's neutral feeling. Then one just tend to ignore. Well, can be very advantageous people to interact with, then one just ignore them. Because they don't interact, they don't arouse any feeling, neither pleasant nor painful. But in general, one should know also with this pleasant feeling that arises with contact with liked people, that is, this contact will be impermanent. So one will not be able to keep up this contact forever, and thereby will not be able to keep up this pleasant feeling either. The Buddha, he put it like this: all meetings, they end in separation. So one can meet somebody and then follow along for a period, but then it ends in separation. Usually, in all circumstances, death, but in many cases much before. And this one should just know that there's no association, even with liked people, with liked company, with liked, attractive, interesting social interaction that can last and thereby provide lasting happiness. So that also is, even with teachers, is also suffering. And this one just should know. Then one can interact with it and also start to interact with people who gives painful feeling and people who gives a boring, neutral, neither painful nor a pleasant feeling. One can interact with them also in another way that is more functional, that is more advantageous for both parties, because there one can arouse one's compassion and one's friendliness and one's rejoicing, mutual joy and one's equanimity on a whole new scale, because one is not dependent upon this pleasant feeling. One is not aversive towards the painful feeling. And what is not, do not have this tendency to ignore neutral feeling connected with a given type of social interaction, with a given set of people or other beings. So, remembering this impermanence in the social sphere, all meetings between individuals end in separation. One relinquishes this association already before it starts. One can say, what's then the point of interacting? Yeah, there can still be advantage in it, a very large advantage, like the interaction there is now. But this doesn't need to lead to attachment, because attachment is a form of clinging, and clinging is a form of craving, and craving is the cause of suffering. So says the Second Noble Truth. So if there can be advantageous kusala interaction, improving the future of both this side of the social interaction and that side of the social interaction, then it's good that it's there. But this should not give rise to clinging, to craving, to suffering. And the way to see it is that there is this impermanence in all meetings, and that all meetings, whether pleasant or painful or neutral, that they end in separation, inevitably, inevitably. Of course, there is only processes interacting, there is no beings, to call down on the first question of no self. So what can be lost in the first place? Huh? Nothing can be lost. Nothing can be lost. I hope this clears the issue. Seeing any social association as evoking a kind of emotion and clinging arising from this pleasant sensation of social association, and then relinquishing that by understanding the impermanence, that all meetings end in separation. Relinquishing that is finishing this clinging, but not the compassion with other beings. I think this is enough for today. Thanks to all Dayakas, to all supporters, to all donors that gives food, and especially the regular donors that keeps these videos coming. Thank you to that. That is very advantageous for many beings. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha, indeed. And may you also indeed have a nice and noble day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Nāgā's Mountain, Pampalela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.
Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.